Yes, sorry, just on a minute, I understand you've seen my movie.
I have.
You've seen it, okay.
I have. How long has this... I gather that this movie and this whole thing has been an incredibly long effort for you.
Well, yes. Almost 11 years. 11 years I was working on this movie.
Did you read the book as a kid, or did you? I mean, because I know it, I think I read it in high school.
Look, fortunately, not as a kid. You know, if you are talking with, if you are both you and me about 18 or 19 years old, because mostly the people are reading this book when they are 18. Now, fortunately, I read this book when I was 45. Huh. Fortunately, I'm saying, because it's such a big difference if you are reading those books. I mean, those serious books like that. When you are 18, and then if you are much more, let's say, experience it, and you are feeling much more, because all of us, we have noticed in our lives so many victories, so many losses, you know, so many things, of course. And it's you must be very sensitive if you really would like to understand the book like The Painted Bird is about. Mm.
So was it, how did you end up reading it? Was it just...
Oh, you know, I was, you know, I love books. You know, I'm reading maybe 3 or 4 books a month, you know, always before I'm going to go to sleep, you know, so I'm not using the pills, I'm using the books, you know, and I'm reading maybe 5 minutes, maybe 2 hours, doesn't matter, and then finally my head is just lingering like that, you know, I can switch off the lamp, you know, I know that in 3 seconds I'm going to sleep. So I remember just only my feeling then when I was reading this book. And believe it or not, after three pages from the first chapter, I felt this is my story, that I must do that as a movie. I must, simply I must. So I felt it, you know, and finally, you know, I really decided. And but that time I was working in my previous movie. So immediately when I finished my previous movie, I decided to really to go further and check who is owning the rights. And it's the Spertus company in Chicago. And I wrote them a letter. Look, my name is Václav. I'm from the Czech Republic, and I'm so very highly interested in The Painted Bird. Is it possible to start to talk? And I didn't expect any response. I didn't, like some guy from the Czech Republic, you know, where is it, you know? But, surprisingly...
At Spertus, they think they know where the Czech Republic is.
Yeah, like that, definitely. So. But they responded to me, and they invited me to come to Chicago and start to talk, you know, so, and it's...
So in that first blush, in that first paragraph, that first chapter, what was it that you connected with?
Look, I just, no, it was about the feeling. You know, nothing special. Just only I felt.
Well, was it about you identifying with it? Was it about the idea that it meant something? Was it?
I know it's a little bit silly what I'm saying.
I'm not silly at all, but.
No, nothing special. Nothing special. I just only felt it. That's all. That's all. Nothing special. No special sentence. Oh my God, this is the point. No. Just feeling. The general feeling. This is wonderful. That I have a treasure in my hands, you know. Mm. That's it.
So what got you to filmmaking and being a director, particularly in general? How was that road? Because it seems like it came fairly late for
you.
Absolutely.
You know, because I've been involved in the film industry when I was 15. And because I love cinema, simply I love cinema, but never I have had an ambition to be a director or the screenwriter, so always I was a production manager. And I like it, really, to organize the people and to organize the shooting, and I really love it. And just only by accident, you know, I directed my first movie, because I'm a member of one theater group in Prague, and I wrote the screenplay, not for the movie, but for the theater. And the title was The Smart Philip, because always I love Raymond Chandler's book and Dashiell Hammett, but Phil Marlowe as a private eye. And I love it. I love it. And still loving those stories. And I so love it. And I said, okay, so I will write a screenplay. So we will make a comedy. It's a parody on the Phil Marlowe as a private eye, as a detective, you know. And it was quite successful, very successful, let's say, as a theater. And finally, I decided to make a movie. And I was thinking about, of course, about some experienced director, because never in my life I directed anything. And finally, I realized, you know, no, Václav, it will not work, you know, because it's your baby, you know, even you are not going to direct it, so you will be in a shooting place every day, and still you will say, director, no, I did have another idea. And his intonation is wrong, you know, so he must say it in that way. So finally, I decided to direct it by myself. And believe it or not, never I directed just a meter, you know. But the film really has had a success in the cinemas. And then I realized that to be a director, it is the, how to say it, the best job. Mm. Because it's so, you can be so creative, you know. So you can have a fantasy and imagination. Wonderful, really great, you know. I really love this profession. It's wonderful to work with all those people and finally to create the movie, the story, you know, so that's it. So, by accident.
Well, it sounds though that you, in some ways, you started the way that a lot of writers start, in that they want to protect their creation, and directing it, it's not putting it in somebody else's hands is the only way to do that.
Yeah, but you know, to be a director and to make movies like The Painted Bird or the previous movies, you must have a really good producer. Mm-hmm. I mean, the producer which is protecting you, which is helping you, and always he just only is ready to fulfill all your wishes. And I have a wonderful producer, me.
When did you meet?
Well, we are, look, and already the screenwriter, because that's the third Václav. And believe it, we are living together 59 years. And we are really friends, you know, we know each other very well. We are sleeping together.
You be
we
careful
are
about me too. Yeah,
well, yes, definitely. And 24 hours a day, so we stay together, you know. So me as a director, I think Václav, you know, for instance, The Painted Bird, you know, it's very, it's an expensive movie, you know, I would like to shoot 1.5 years. I would like to shoot chronologically, you know, because I really wish that the boy will grow up naturally, you know. And he said, of course, you can do that. Do what you want.
Good
and
job.
Said, thank you, Arslan.
Well, it is a daring, I mean, everything about this movie is daring. It is not, it is a challenging movie.
Yes.
I sat and watched it alone in a screening room because it's a midday screening and I'm pretty sure it scared everybody. I mean, the movie scares people because they hear it's long and they hear it's black and white and they hear it's in other languages and, you know, people get nervous. But it's incredibly powerful. Did you know from pretty early on that you wanted it to be as long as it was? Did you kind of have a sense of the pace that you were going for and the choices that you made, or did it take time to figure it out?
That's a good question. Look, you know, so, well, maybe I can say that never I'm speculating, you know, so never I'm thinking about those things, you know, just only my past or my way, my journey is my heart. So what I'm feeling, so that's good. It doesn't mean that the film is going to be wonderful. It's going to be okay. Simply, I am doing the best, everything what I can do, so I will do. You know, so what I'm feeling, you know, I'm just only going to fulfill. And just, it's about my emotions, you know. So I said that my brain's like yours. It's just only split in two parts. The one is really very logic, and the second, it's a chaos. About the feelings, about the empathy, you know. So, and then this is my radar here, you know. I'm following the left part of my brain, and I'm just only doing what I'm feeling. That's all. That's all. That's all. Never speculating, never thinking about the thing. The people are, for instance, they said, Václav, it's wonderful that your film been selected to the main competition in Venice. So you was planning to do that? I said, no, of course not. I was not thinking about it. I just want to make a movie. So that's all, and of course I appreciated that the film being selected to Venice, of course, but it wasn't my ambition.
But at some point you had to tell people who were going to give you money what it is you were going to do, I assume, roughly.
You know, so those people, they'll give me money, you know, so maybe they do have much higher ambitions than me.
So do you think some of the people who funded you expected some other movie to come out of it?
No, it didn't happen, you know, because I invited all my, let's say, co-producers and investors to do Venice. Too. And when the screening finished, you know, so all of them, they were crying, you know, and they were so happy because we have had a 10-minute standing ovation there, you know, and I was so happy because they were happy that I didn't disappoint them, you know, so that's most important for me, you know.
Okay, but I'm still, you. At some okay. point, you're buying, you're making a choice that you're making in black and white. You're
yeah.
making pacing choices, obviously. You know, just even the first sequence, the son, the kid, and the grandmother. You know, the desolation of that space, the emptiness of it, letting them breathe in it, are all choices that you made as director. But at some point, I assume you knew that was coming, and you expressed that to people. Yes.
Yeah.
So, is that choice? Was that choice just obvious? Is that just your heart?
It was.
It's going to take you there, and
no, it was obvious. It was obvious. You know, because I must tell you when I will repeat, I was working on this for almost 11 years, but many years before I was thinking of it, you know, and I just only tried to find out the key which I can open the door, and behind the door was a story. And since very first beginning, I was feeling that this film must be real or must be truthful. Must be truthful. And this is the difference, you know, so because, for instance, so many people are saying, you know, that my film is violent and brutal. And I can say very frankly that other movies are much more violent, and they are bringing so much more brutality. Not me, not The Painted Bird, because I'm not showing those things. It's not a...
Right.
No, it's just only in the mind of all those people that are watching my movie, because I'm not showing this. But
you connect emotionally.
Right. Yes.
That's what hurts. I mean, that's you watch Terminator movies all day long.
That's correct. But my ambition as a director, that film, the story must be truthful, not the fairy tale, not the fiction, let's say. And that's why the film is so strong, because the people, they really, really believe it, that it could happen, and it's very painful. And if this film is going to be in color, so it will be a damage, absolute damage, you know, because it must be black and white, because it is reinforcing that the film is going to be really truthful. That was the same with the English language. So many potential co-producers I met in Berlin or in Cannes, they said, Václav, so we will think of it, but this film must be in English language. And I said, I'm so sorry. If this film is going to be in English language, it will be a damage. It will be tragedy. It will be a disaster, because nobody then will believe it. You know, so if the Russian soldiers and the German soldiers and villagers and the boy, all of them, they are fluently speaking English language. So the question is, why they are not going together to the bar and drink beer? You know, why any war is going on, of course, you know. So of course that's about that the boy is different and the people are different, of course. It's about this. It's one of the levels on this movie. So I was thinking of it very much, of course, you know. For instance, try to imagine that the Schindler's List is going to be in color. It will be a disaster too. It will be a disaster. So that's but everything I was feeling, you know, I didn't speculate that, for instance, last year Roma is black and white movie and Oscar winner, of course, that's wonderful, but I'm not interested in. And my colleague Pavel Pavlikovsky, which made the Cold War, or the Ida, also the black and white. It's not the issue. The issue is my movie, of course. And I'm just only trying to help my movie. Because even I'm a director, and I'm running the crew, and I'm just only directing the actors, I have one lot, which is much higher than me. That's the movie. I'm serving. I'm just serving to the movie. You know, this is our lot, or my lot.
In some ways, it's almost a silent movie. I mean, obviously, there is dialogue, and there's...
Well...
That's not non-existent. But much of it is told visually, instead of verbally.
But the sound is great, I suppose, you know, even because, you know, when I was writing the screenplay, anyway, I wrote 17 versions of the screenplay, and I was working on it 3 years, till I finally felt, felt that this is the last version, that I was really feeling that, you know, I can't really to continue, and that the best way how to really to push the screenplay forward is just only to do that, just only to shoot it. But I just only forget what was your question,
the screenplay. We were talking about the choices and
the sound. Sorry, the sound. Yeah. Okay, so I didn't feel that I needed dialogues, you know, because we are filmmakers, we are not writers, you know. I mean that we as a filmmakers, our language is picture and the sound. because we are filmmakers. And if, for instance, today, if you are watching any TV series, doesn't matter what, the people are still talking, you know, and maybe they are repeating the information three times because maybe they are thinking that the audience is so stupid they can't catch it, you know. So it's sometimes, it's a strange. I saw one movie, it was a disaster, the winter scene, and the camera is just very slowly going from right to the left, mm-hmm. and you see the winter and the buildings, they're covered by snow, and really heavy snowing, and narrator is saying, the winter did come. You know, everywhere was the snow. And you saw it on the screen, you know. So the information is double. You know, so that's crazy. And, but, you know, because you can tell the story without a dialogue, of course. It's about the acting, it's about the atmosphere, it's about the camera, it's about the sound, of course. And the sound was quite difficult in The Painted Bird because no dialogues there, in fact, only 9 minutes together. Mm-hmm. And that was really, believe me. So we worked on the sound 5 months. And finally, we mixed 5,000 cues. the sound is great. And we mix it in Dolby Atmos. And in Dolby Atmos, it's a... Oh, my God, it's wonderful.
I'm actually curious, since you bring up the sound, that because I went through this once before. There's a movie called The Gray Zone that was, I think, a terrific movie. And it also has Harvey Keitel in it. And in that movie, everybody was told to kind of speak their own natural dialect.
Yeah, yeah.
And except he wanted to do German. So then he committed to it and he decided to do it. Which Tim Blake Nelson is okay with, apparently. But I found a little odd. In this movie, it seems like he was ultimately, it sounds like he prepared for it and then he was dubbed anyway.
Yeah, yeah, sure.
And I think there were two or three cases where there were actors who I was familiar with whose voices were not the voices I was expecting.
No, of course not, you know, because it's an inter-Slavic language. It's invented language, so nobody speaks in inter-Slavic language. Mm-hmm. And of course, for Harvey Keitel, Julian Sands, for instance, was the best, you know, really, you know, so he's like a monkey, so he just only, he was really hearing, you know, but it is mission impossible to say impossible. Mm. Absolutely, for you, for the Americans or for the English speaking people, it's absolutely impossible to say. 3333 stříbrných stříkaček stříkalo přes 3333 stříbrných střech. You can't say it. But it's not your fault. It's not my merit. It's just only my language. But yes, of course, be not. Yes, sure.
No. I once had a TV thing where there was an actor we hired who did voices. He did imitations of everybody. Mm. And he had to call somebody a schmuck.
Schmuck, yes.
And he was not Jewish at all. And he could not say the word schmuck. You could say sh and muck, but he couldn't. It would come out smuck every time. He just never could hit that note.
But the truth is that the Harvey Keitel and all other actors, so they had to speak in the inter-Slavic language because of lip sync. You know, that's so Harvey really said all his lines.
So it matched.
Yes, in inter-Slavic language.
Really. But ultimately, the detail was that important to you.
Yeah. Because of the lip sync, because you. I mean, mostly here in the United States, you know, so it's you are not dubbing the movies,
right.
You know, so and then you can see if the lip sync is different than the language is, mm-hmm. you know, so and so that's, for instance, Harvey did have a dialogue coach and he was during the shooting day, so he still was repeating his lines, you know, in inter-Slavic language. So that was wonderful access from him, of course, and the other two. And the Barry Pepper is speaking in Russian language. Mm-hmm. Just only two lines, but also he had to speak in Russian language.
The kid actually kind of uses his lack of speaking as a shield.
Yeah.
It's almost like every time he opens his mouth, it endangers him because somebody figures something out about him.
Surprise.
Yeah. Well, they don't know what, you don't know what he is.
Yeah,
you just look
at
him and people tell him what he is.
Yeah.
But it's almost like protective to be silent for him.
Yeah, definitely. Because I was just only feeling that I can do that, of course, you know. And not to explain everything just only in the very beginning.
Mm-hmm.
Just only to bring this secret to the final scene, to the final catharsis of the movie, of course, you know. Who is he? You know, what he's doing there? You know, where are his parents, you know? Questions. And if I think that if really you would like to pay attention, or you are wishing that the audience will pay attention on your movie, so in the questions. They must have a questions, you know, why? And they are not boring, because they are still finding the responses by themselves, you know. So that's why finally in the end of my movie I explain it. What happened? What was the reason the boy was with his auntie somewhere, a bandit, you know?
Yeah. Well, also it's interesting because he is coming of age physically at the same time as the story is being told. It's all the mystery. He's figuring out the mysteries of himself, necessarily by choice.
Correct.
But it's fascinating. So was there anything about in the storytelling that you were like, this is going to be too much, or I'm afraid of this, or is there anything you didn't do because it was too much for an audience, do you think? Or
No.
Because it is the funny thing is, it's a compliment, I think, to say it is a roller coaster experience. It is a hard movie in that you're going through real emotions and you are scared for this kid in a real way from beginning to end. You know, there are moments of relief and then those are taken away at times. But you just were, this is what it is, and
I didn't have any doubts, you know, that really I would like to do that, or just only excluding maybe one scene, but then I will explain you. But that's what I said, you know, so I didn't want to make a shock movie. You know, I didn't want to show the violence. I didn't want to show the brutality. So always in all those very tough, and I know that those scenes are really tough, but always the camera is behind, not on the front view. Only behind behind the scene, in fact, and everything was going on.
I think that's scarier for the audience on some level.
But it's, you know, it's up to you. It's your choice. Me as a director, I'm not showing to you. It's up to you. Not just, I mean, of course, you personally or other audience. And it's really up to you. So how much, you know, how so far really you can imagine by yourself in your mind what's going on the screen. Mm-hmm. Because wonderful. I am thinking that this film is about the hope and the love and the good. And the people are saying, Václav, you must be crazy. This is not about the hope. And I said, yes, I'm so sorry. You know, because if we as an artist would like to accent that, for instance, the hope is one of the most important things in our life. So when you will realize it, if you are missing this, when you will really, let's say, you know that how the love is important is when you are missing the love, you know. You know, if you are healthy, so then you really realize it how wonderful it is if you, till you will get the disease. And when you will get disease, you go, oh my God, healthy is so important. So that's, the painted bird is based on the opposites, on the opposite things, you know, like the yin-yang, you know, the graphic symbol, that's it. So that's the principle of my movie, you know. So I know that some people, they don't understand, you know, and they just only, they got the heart attack. But it's not my fault. They did it by themselves.
Well, it's in some ways, it's what people yearn for and fear at the same time.
Yeah. No, you know.
You know, horror movies kind of let you, weirdly, they let you off the hook because you have that scare and then there's, you know, the lights come on, essentially. Right. Constantly, but this is a human being. I mean, when you actually create a full person,
you know,
instead of a cartoon.
Yeah, that's not the, yes, thank you very much for that. It's not a cartoon. Because, for instance, so many movies aren't simply cartoon. So in so many movies, the people are killing each other so much, you know. So you've seen the front views, somebody will take a shotgun, you know, like just only put him here and the brain is somewhere, painted the whole Los Angeles. But nobody cares, you know, because it's fairy tale. It's a fiction, you know, and the people are watching those movies and they are drinking wine. And just calling to the kitchen, ma, honey, please bring another bottle, you know, and maybe some toast, you know, like that. And this is the problem, you know, so maybe, I don't know, maybe does exist unwritten deal between the audience and the filmmakers. And maybe the audience is saying in general, look, you filmmakers, do whatever you want, but must be a fairy tale, not the truth. Because the truth is always painful. And my movie is painful, I know that. Because very sensitive people, if they are really thinking of it, they know that in that very second, now when we are doing this interview here in your house in Los Angeles, in this very second, somebody in Syria or in Afghanistan somewhere is going to be murdered, killed, raped, burnt in this second, you know. So The Painted Bird is a timeless and universal story. And it's not about the Holocaust, in fact, you know. It's not so important that the main character is a Jew. It's about the mankind. It's about us, you know. And it should be very painful. Of course, it is.
Well, the Kurds are running for their lives
right now.
And by choice, you know, choice of a you know, president who kind of wings it.
that Erdogan, yes, of course, you know, he attacked another, you know, so his soldiers are killing all those innocent people in this moment, you know. So thousands and thousands refugees, you know, just only, which they would like simply survive, just only serve their lives, you know, they just only want back, you know, and that's all. It's crazy. It's crazy, and that's what The Painted Bird is about too, of course, you know. Mm. Because unfortunately, you know, this is about us, and what I said, it's painful. But we must have eyes open. We must hear it, you know, we must listen to those people. We must struggle against the fascism and against all those people which are bringing the hateness. You know, between the people which are starting the wars? No, of course not, you know. We can't live just only in the world of the Avengers. You know, we can't. We are living in a real world, you know.
Though I personally, I feel like there's something to the world of the Avengers, not necessarily that particular movie, but that there is something about that escapism and pure fun also.
Yeah.
You know, and there's value, and it's an interesting, because we're having this debate because of Marty Scorsese and Francis Coppola lately.
Yes.
But I believe in both when they're well done. I mean, ultimately for me,
sure.
Judgment of a movie is it good at what it's trying to do, not
I like all genres of the movies. Yeah. You know, for instance, I love westerns. I love comedies, but just only under one condition: must be good. Must be really good, you know. Thrillers and action movie doesn't matter, you know. Must be good and must be just not a speculation, you know. Because if you are feeling that you are just only watching the movie and director is really speculating, that is, so you are feeling that because you are not stupid, and then you don't like this movie, you know. And when it's really open heart, open mind, you know, it doesn't matter what, you can enjoy it. Of course, you can enjoy it, but it's also drama. Yeah. And me as a director, I'm not so interested in comedies. I really very glad to watch them, you know, because I'm not just only like that at it. I wake up every morning and I was thinking of all those things, of course, you know. I have 4 children, you know, I really do love them, you know, and I really like to smile, of course, you know. But as an artist, I'm not interested in comedies. Yeah. I'm just only interested in human beings, in people. What kind of lives they do have, you know, so what are they feeling, you know, what they would like to do, you know, so how they would like to find out the balance, to be with themselves, because this is one of the hardest jobs in our life, to be with ourselves.
Well, it's interesting year in that there are 3 World War II based movies, which are all very different. Yours is very direct and, as you say, very real. Malick is kind of using the heroic romantic genre to tell a story of somebody who refused to be involved. And then there's Jojo Rabbit, which is a true satire about being sucked into that world.
Hitler is going to be his best friend of the small...
Well, I don't know. You haven't seen the movie yet, I guess.
I haven't seen it. It's
brilliant, I believe. It's about a 10-year-old boy or 9-year-old boy who wants to be part of something. And because he's in Berlin, the thing he wants to be part of is the Nazis, because what's there. And he is disabused of this notion as the movie goes along. Yeah. But it is a satire. And Hitler is, you know, his imaginary friend, because he's been told Hitler's your friend.
Yeah.
And eventually, not so much.
You know, that's great to hear it, you know, but I must tell you very openly that I can't do this movie, you know, because that was your question and my response when you was asking if any scene really shake me. Well, it happened, you know. There's a scene when the train is bringing all those people to the concentration camp. and the Mido and the those prisoners, the Jews are trying to escape from the train, and the SS soldiers, they are just only shooting them as a rabbits. And when we shoot it inside, I mean, when we were with the camera inside in the wagon, and I just only used all the extras being there, maybe 100 people, you know, I just only started to cry. And we couldn't shoot maybe more than 1 hour because I was crying like that. I'm not Jew, but my father, grandfather was a Jew. And originally, the Jewish part of our family lived in Vienna. And 18 of them being killed in Treblinka, in the concentration camp. So when I was shooting this scene, so I haven't seen the extras. I've seen the people from my family. I never met, I will going to meet them. You know, and it was so tough for me, you know. So I was really crying so much, you know. And I'm not ashamed on that because, you know, simply it happened, you know. So and well, just one scene really shake me like that, you know. So
I also was in tears through that. I mean, it's horrifying.
Yeah.
But as you say, it's still sadly universal. It's not just.
Yeah, it's not just period movie.
Yeah.
It's not a historical movie. It's a timeless story. Mm-hmm. It doesn't matter. It should, you know, this the painted bird just means that you are different. This is the biggest message of this movie, and maybe that's an explanation why such a controversial and very heavy book is really begin to be a bestseller, because people, I mean, generally they do understand how difficult it is to be different, and it's not about your skin that you have a yellow or white or black, red doesn't matter. You are simply different. So you are wearing the different clothes, so you have a different ideas, you have a different ambitions, so you are not a member of the flock. And then, of course, what are all other people or the animals are doing? Just only they try to kill you, you know. And that's it. This is the biggest message. So maybe so that's why the people, they do understand what does it mean that all, if you are different, always you have a trouble. Mm-hmm. Always.
So I think one of the things about the film that comes through is that we're all actually painted birds.
Yeah.
Nobody, even though people who are surviving and running the towns that he runs into and so forth are different. They're not. We're not. I think in some ways this whole Trumpism movement and nationalism movement is a fear of, you know, the fear of universalism.
Yes.
Is a fear of losing your identity when in fact you don't have that identity. You are each of us is an individual. We're not part of a group in that kind of cellular way.
I agree.
And people being disconnected is scary. People being in themselves is scary for people.
Yeah, that's the point. I agree with you.
We Absolutely. Have to evolve somehow.
Yes. Really. Yeah, I can't comment it because everything what you are saying, that's correct. I totally agree with that.
Did you have any sense of Kosinski before you read this book,
or was it nothing, no connections? Nothing.
No.
Just only I saw
being there?
The 1976 movie being there. With Peter Sellers, which is a wonderful movie, being nominated for the best movie from the Oscar, of course, you know, and the Peter Sellers was great in that movie, you know, it's so funny, but it's really sad. In fact, it's a sad story.
Oh,
even
yeah.
It's a comedy. It's very sad, of course, you know.
And but still current.
Yeah,
for
yeah,
horrifically.
Yeah.
We have Chance the Gardener in office now.
And I have seen The Rats, directed by Warren Beatty.
Mm-hmm.
And Jerzy Kosinski, so he was a co-writer on the screenplay.
Mm-hmm.
So just only two experiences before The Painted Bird.
Yeah.
I know who was there, you know,
right.
So I have had about him, you know, but no. Just The Painted Bird was the first. Look,
well, this is pretty much his story.
Yeah.
And it is. I mean, I think people thought it was unfilmable for a long time.
Yes. You know, so many people ask me, Václav, you know, you must be crazy. It is mission impossible to do that as a movie. How you would like to do that? And I said, look, I can't explain it, you know, because everything is here in my mind, you know, and I can't explain every shot, you know. Believe me that hopefully I know what to do.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and then just only when I will finish the movie and you will watch it, so then you can judge it. But not now, you know, because I can't say anything. Because only director has the idea, you know. The film, in fact, is done here. You know, you are just only going to realize, and you are just only trying to find out the better ways how to do that. But in fact, the movie is here from the very first beginning. And your right arm, or the closest colleague, is your DOP. And the DOP in the painted bird is Vladimir Smutný. And Vladimir Smutný, I think that you will agree, it's such a stunning camera. The wonderful pictures, you know. So really, that his camera is helping to bring the story and still to push forward, you know, and go straight on it. So, no, well, yes, but I understand, you know. So nobody could believe it. I will really do that.
Including the guys in Chicago, apparently.
Yes.
So did you? Was post-production big challenge for you, or did you kind of know what it was going
yes,
in?
And yes, definitely, because the post-production was, of course, about the editing. So the first rough cut, the first version of rough cut, did have 4 hours and 27 minutes. Well,
which is not that unusual.
Yeah,
you didn't cut as much
unusual,
as a lot of people,
you know. So and the final cut is 2 hours and 49 minutes, including the final credits and the roll up. So let's say it's about 8 minutes, so the film does have 2 hours and 41 minutes.
Mm-hmm.
And the first version of rough cut was more than 4 hours, 4.5.
Mm-hmm.
So it was really very. Let's say, not well, it was quite difficult, you know, because, you know, I am a director, you know, even it's my baby, believe it, you know, if I am feeling that this scene is, because of this scene, the film is losing the tempo and then logically the rhythm, you know, so I will just only cut it off. Even the scene is wonderful, even the shots are great, even the actors are perfect, you know, sorry, you know. Please go to the dustbin. I don't need you.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so that's so the editing, of course, the sound I did mention. So we worked on the sound more than 5 months, and of course the VFX, because the many things, all animals. I mean, the scenes with the animals being used as a VFX.
Mm.
So no animal being harmed. You know, because it's crazy, you know, because some people.
Not even a chicken.
Yeah. Well, no, of course not. No, believe me. Just only one. This was a fish. And, but we bought the fish, which was already dead.
There you go.
Okay, when the boy is just only sitting on the lake, you know, and he's just working on a fish. So we bought the fish, which was already dead, but the horse, Fredka, birds, doesn't matter what. All those animals stay alive because it's a wonderful VFX work. Wonderful, wonderful, really great. And for instance, the horse, when they just break his neck, it was a model being produced in Hungary in a life size, of course, you know. Wow, I'm not crazy.
Right.
I'm not crazy. But you know, it's a little bit crazy, you know, that for instance, those people, I do understand really, they would like to protect the animals, you know, so and never I'm going to harm to any animal. But in the other hand, you know, all of us, we are eating every day. So many dead animals and nobody takes care. Yeah.
Okay. That's another movie.
Yeah.
So you, I mean, for you, it was really whittling away. You had this 4.5 hours, and then for you, it was really more about just what you were pulling back more than what
you
were.
The film, it's not about that you have a line, you know, and you are saying, well, the film must have not more than 2 hours, you know, or not more than 3 hours.
Right.
It's just only also about, again, about your feeling. So my feeling and my editor was exactly 2 hours and 49 minutes.
Mm-hmm.
But maybe it should be longer. It should be longer. And my producer never will complain.
Right.
Never. You know, but it's about, you know, that you are feeling this is the right size, this is the right length, you know. This length is really, really good, and it's very helpful to tell the story. You know, and it's not about must be, not more than.
Right.
No,
I was thinking more in the idea that some directors discover things about the movie and adjust them as they do editing.
Yeah.
It sounds like you pretty much had the thing, the whole, and then you just brought back the pieces that weren't necessary to make it happen.
No, not my issue. Not my case.
Right. So what was it like when you showed the movie for the first time? What was it like when you showed the movie to an audience for the first time? What was the experience for
Experience?
For you?
Well, you know, this film brought me many things, you know. And what I'm really appreciate and really would like to thank that more sensitivity and more empathy to my heart, you know, and it's really good to live with all those things, you know, that you are feeling much more, that you are not just on a stone, not the Oliver Stone, right. But the stone, okay, the stone which is not feeling nothing,
right.
Nothing, you know, you are not interested in people around, you know, so you are just only selfish, you know, you are thinking only about you, you know, so, and this film just only pushed me forward, you know, to feel much more.
But when you went to Venice,
yes,
and you're putting this in front of this audience, did you watch the movie when?
Yeah, I watched. Of course, I had to stay there.
So what was that like for you? Was it scary? Did you not know whether how the reaction would be, or
no?
Could you feel the room as it?
No. Some people they said to me, Václav, you must be nervous, and I said, I am not nervous. I simply did the good I best. Everything. That's all. You know, I'm just only naked here. You know, everybody, if they want so, they can lynch me, they can beat me, you know, or they can embrace me, or they can kiss me. It's up to them. I am coming here with my movie, which is, let's say, absolutely honest. You know, no speculation. Just honestly, I'm bringing my movie here to the Venice. And I didn't come to compete. I did come to show it. No, that's it. So I wasn't nervous, you know. So I was just only curious, you know. So how many people will kiss me and how many people will beat me, you know. And much more people kissed me.
And what was it like when they kissed you?
Yeah.
What was it like for you when you could tell that they liked the movie?
Yeah.
Did it matter to you? Did it?
No, yes, of course, you know. So look, most of the directors are saying, I am directing my movies because of the audience. So we are making the movies for the audience. And maybe I am just only one director around the world, and I say, no, I am doing the films for myself, because I have to.
So whatever happened was ultimately
of course I'm
better to be nice.
I'm interested whatever will happen,
right.
Of course, you know. But I am saying very openly and very frankly, the first what I'm doing is doing the film for me, for myself, because I am feeling the necessity to really do that,
mm-hmm.
You know. And of course I am glad if thousands and thousands other people, they are following me, of course, and they are saying, Václav, thank you very much, we do understand, you know. And some people, they don't, of course, but I do respect it. Nobody made a movie which everybody fall in love. Nobody.
Mm-hmm.
The movie always has some people which they like it, they really love it, you know, and they hate it. They don't like it. That's our life. Mm. Fortunately, it's wonderful. That's great. And me as a director, I'm respecting all those people, of course.
But that's the right side of your brain, not the left side of your brain.
Yeah. Yeah, that's it. Yeah.
So, does this? You're now here in LA, kind of promoting the movie, and it's coming out in theaters, and also heading to the Academy Award process. Is it a novelty? Is it just interesting? Is it just the opportunity to share your movie, or do you care ultimately?
All of it together, of course, you know. So yesterday we have had a first screening here in Neue House, Hollywood, you know, and it was really it was wonderful to talk with all those people after the screening, you know, if those people, they are really going to be open and they are going to say, oh my God, yes, I'm thinking that, you know, and I'm so glad to hear it, you know, if the people, they stopped for a moment and they just only went to think about all the things, you know, they normally they are not thinking about, you know, so mm-hmm. that's feeling great. And for instance, somebody told me, you know, so my family. I just only realized that my family is the biggest treasure in my life, what I do have. And if somebody is saying to you this, so then your film complete a mission. So that's it. You know, that's so simple. You know, I'm really glad to hear it. Sure, of course.
I came out of the theater and the publicist was there and, what do you think? And I'm like, I couldn't speak. I'm not ready to have a conversation about this.
That's very important what you said, because much better is to talk to all those people, let's say 1 week after the screening, not immediately when the screening's finished, you know, because the people, they are so full of the emotions, you know, and they need time really to put it as a puzzle, you know, just only piece to piece, and finally to create a picture, you know, finally to understand, you know, it takes a few days, not just only a minute after the screening. What is your opinion? It's crazy. It's crazy. You know, it's not a football match. What right. is your opinion? Of course, it's not a baseball, you know.
Well, sometimes it is. I mean, that's the thing. It's like a friend of mine at a studio once said, can't you just enjoy a movie? Because I was being critical of whatever detail. And I'm like, if I'm thinking about how the movie's cut while I'm watching it, that's a problem with the movie. Yeah. It's not because I can't enjoy a movie.
Yeah, yeah.
It's because I'm, you know, my brain is thinking of something else because there's nothing to watch on the screen. So when you're, as an audience, when you're overwhelmed with the feelings, it's a beautiful thing and a rare thing. It's not it doesn't happen every day.
Yeah,
so
absolutely.
It's a pleasure to happen.
I agree. Thank you.
Mm. So do you have any idea what's next, or are you waiting for your next 10-year journey?
Well, you know, who knows? You know, I'm open, you know, because, you know, I will tell you the story, maybe the last one, you know, okay, because they just only gave us 30 minutes, but doesn't matter. It happened maybe 6 or 7 years ago, and I've been in Cannes. Uh-huh. And that time I was interested just only to persuade some potentially really good sales agent which should be interested in my movie. And I was sitting with one woman, I suppose. She was the Spanish sales agent. And I was working on the painting, but only that time, 5 years.
Mm.
And she said, Václav, it's incredible. You are working on your movie 5 years. It's oh my God, you know, how you can do that, how you could sustain yourself. And I was thinking about my response, just wanted to explain it shortly. And finally, I got the idea. I said, I think that her name was Paola. And I said, Paola, in fact, we as a filmmakers, we do have a two ways where to go. First is love, second is sex. That's all. If you are making a sex as a filmmaker, so you are producing 12 films a year, or dozens TV miniseries, doesn't matter what, you know, that's a sex. All love. And I am preferring love to sex. And if you fall in love, so then you can survive everything, you know. You can survive almost 11 years with just only one movie, because this movie is simply your love. And if your question is, what's going to be next? So my response must be the love again. Not the sex, must be a love. But I don't know where I will meet my next love, you know. And I will not walk, you know, love, where are you? Because if you are doing this, so never you will find it. The love must find you by herself or itself, you know.
So you're not going to have a little cheap sex on the side in the meantime?
It simply doesn't matter. It's just only a torch during the daylight, you know. So no. So
you have no urge to go off and have a little milky on the side.
Yeah. So I don't know what it will happen. I don't know what it will happen. It's just only necessary. It's just only necessary. Again, the heart must be open. Your mind must be open, you know. And then I'm quite sure something will come. I don't know what's going to be, you know.
But the next one will be love. It won't be.
Must be. Not sex. Must be a love. You know, and it's not about that. It must be my screenplay. You know, so I'm really very open to direct any other screenplay, but must be love. Must be good. I must believe it. You know, it must be. It's about the confidence. You know, it's about all those things. You know, and then you can do everything you want. Everything. That's it. So simple.
Thank you so much for your time.
I thank you.
Appreciate it.
Thank you.